Hi everyone, welcome to another Clean Machine Live. I'm Jeff Palmer, CEO and founder of Clean Machine Plant-Based Fitness Nutrition. The disclaimer, this video is for informational educational purposes only and is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease. And we will be covering some of the research on a particular problem with oxalates. So, you know, when I have conversations and boards and in lectures and stuff like that, you know, I get the questions about phytates and oxalates. So what are these? These are phytochemicals that are produced by plants, but they're also produced, phytates and oxalates are also produced by animals too as well. So plants aren't the only source of these. As a matter of fact, we're going to talk about oxalates today. And show why they may not be as big an issue as many people make them out to be, and what may be the more serious concern for oxalates. So, you know, when you hear the anti-nutrient tag claim, what happens is the body has ways of regulating these so-called anti-nutrients. And they get the misnomer of anti-nutrients because they can inhibit or slow the amount of nutrients going into the system. Now, as we discussed in one of my previous ones on phytates, phytates bind with iron, and they're called an anti-nutrient too. But this phytate binding to some iron, about 25 to 35% of the iron, turns out is actually a good thing because it slows or inhibits the body's uptake of this, which is actually a good thing. New study out of the University of Oxford showed that our body actually does much better when we take small amounts of iron at a small dosage at a time. Now, the phytate binds to the iron and then keeps it from oxidizing, which is a good thing because oxidized iron can actually stimulate cancer cell growth. So we see now how the phytates, which really had a negative thing, we now know phytates or phytic acid, or also called IP6, actually has a protective effect. It actually can kill cancer cells, whereas heme iron, iron found in animal products, can actually cause cancers to be formed in the human body, especially in colon cancers, which is the number two cancer killer for Americans. So let's go back to oxalates. Phytates and oxalates are often lumped together, but they're very different chemicals and do different things. So the big concern about oxalates is that oxalates can combine with calcium and therefore reduce the amount of calcium uptake. But it turns out that's probably a better thing too. Too much calcium getting into the bloodstream can cause calcification. Calcification is the hardening of plaques in the arteries. And when that happens, you can get into real trouble, both with heart attack, stroke, high blood pressure, et cetera. So we don't want too much calcium flooding into our bloodstream. And the plants have this built-in mechanism of binding through oxalates to this. Now, are too much oxalates not good for the human body? Well, oxalates can bind to calcium inside our body too, and then group together and form oxalate stones or kidney stones. Now, this is a problem, but the problem with the research in the beginning was this tying into the assumption that higher amount of dietary oxalates would yield a higher amount of kidney stones. And that does not seem to be the case in, as far as research goes. So I did some more digging and find out exactly why that's not the case, especially of those on a strict plant-based diet or a vegan lifestyle. So let's dive into that because the answer lies in our gut microbiome. So it's not just a chemical and what does it do in the body, but how is that chemical utilized? How is it treated by our microbiome? How is it changed by our microbiome? And how does it affect our body differently because of our interaction with our microbiome? That's the important part that we were missing out by just oversimplifying and saying higher oxalate means higher kidney stones when it's not the case at all in certain cases. So let's look at what the real situation is. So inside of our gut, there is a specific bacteria that loves to eat oxalates. And here's the name of the bacteria. Oxalobacter formigenes. So oxalobacter, it's an oxalate eating bacteria. That's what it does. So when you eat fiber, like plants like rhubarb or spinach, these are plants, dark greens, that are high in fiber. Well, guess what these oxalobacter bacteria actually feed on, besides oxalates? Fiber. What's really cool is the more fiber you consume, the more oxalobacter formigenes or oformigenes bacteria that you get. So this is really cool because if you eat more spinach, you're getting more fiber, which raises your oxalobacteria, which eats the oxalates that are in the spinach. Well, there you have it, a perfect microbiome balance. Our body has adapted from nature to say, okay, there's some oxalates in the plant that the plant uses for its own purposes, but our bacteria, our microbiome has adapted to eat up those oxalates so that they don't form some bad things. But catch this, these oxalobacter bacteria, I'll call them oformigenes, oxalobacter bacteria. So oformigenes actually not only eats up that, but it tells the cells in our body to reduce the amount because there's some coming in. So here's the real truth on it. Where does oxalic acid or oxalates come from? Two different places. One, our diet, plants, but animal products also have oxalates in them because all animals, including humans, create our own oxalates, our own oxalic acid. We generate inside of our body through body processes. So over half of all the oxalates that are in our body actually are made by our own body. So our body wouldn't make something that would harm us, right? So this makes a lot more sense. But if we're getting something in our diet that is higher in a certain nutrient, one, our first line of defense, the bacteria, the oxalobacter bacteria, actually can chew up and eat up. And here's a study that showed it degraded up to 98% in vitro. That's in a dish. They took the actual oxalates, put it with the bacteria, the oxalobacter bacteria, and it ate up 98% of the oxalates. So if you have a healthy gut, this may not be an issue at all if you have allowed your gut to build up this bacteria, and it builds it up by consuming fiber. So when you're not eating a high fiber diet, that oxalobacter bacteria goes down. And then you consume high amounts of oxalates, whether it be plant or animal, now you've got a problem. So it's more the fiber that is the problem. Low fiber is what's causing this surplus of oxalates to get into the system because you're not giving the oxalobacteria that would bring down the oxalates enough of its own food source, which is fiber. It's a fiber eating microbiotic. So it is more the fiber that's the issue. Now, how could we test this? Well, this is interesting. I'm going to post up the first study on the screen. So those of you who are watching on Facebook can do it. And the first one, the first study that I'm going to post up here is a study that actually shows exactly how our body balances it. And I'll put this, let's see if I can put this in the comments section. And then I'll show it on the screen there. So the study is gut microbiota and oxalate homeostasis. Homeostasis is balance. So what our body wants to do is balance the amount of oxalates. A little bit of oxalates don't harm us. Obviously, our body is creating its own oxalates, so no big deal. What we don't want is get too much of them and allow excess calcium, which would be in the bloodstream, to then actually bind to those oxalates, forming kidney stones. That's what we don't want. So this is how it does it. So the microbiota themselves actually communicate to our cells and say, hey, wait, there's oxalates coming in. And it actually gets our body to reduce or cast out through urine any excess oxalates to lower the blood oxalate levels so that dietary oxalates can come in and it maintain homeostasis. How cool is this? These microbiome want the health of our body. So they are working to say, thank you for feeding me all that fiber and the oxalates. Come on, bring it in. In return, I'll communicate to your body and keep you healthy. You keep me healthy, says the oxalobacter, and I'll keep you healthy. It's a perfect symbiotic relationship. We feed them, they help us maintain a balance of oxalates in our system. It's a beautiful thing. Okay, so this study actually says that introducing human oxalate consuming bacteria to, in this case, it was a mouse study, and trust me, I don't condone animal studies at all. I'm looking forward to the day we end all animal research. But this one showed that introducing human oxalate consuming bacteria, the actual oxalobacter bacteria, resulted in the normalization of what's called hyperoxaluria or hyperoxalemia, which is too high in the bloodstream or too high in the tissues of oxalates, which puts you at risk for kidney stones. So just by putting one dose of these probiotics into the system, neutralize the oxalate. So this is pretty interesting. But on the reverse side, they've shown the use of antibiotics. And don't get me wrong, I'm saying this because this is what's quoted in the study. Don't get me wrong, there is a proper use of antibiotics, and you should talk with your physician about what's good and what are the risks. But I'm just going to quote from the studies that the use of antibiotics can wipe out these good oxalate eating bacteria. The therapeutic use of antibiotics and other drugs may contribute to the loss of oxalobacteria in the gut. Now, what happens when you use antibiotics and you wipe out these oxalate-eating bacteria, then the normal foods you do don't get properly processed by the oxalate-eating bacteria because you've wiped them out because of the antibiotics, and then those oxalates get into the system. So here is the problem, and this study kind of says it all. This next study I'm going to post in the comment section. Found that, and I'll post it up on the screen there. So oxalobacter may reduce the risk of calcium oxalate kidney stones. It says it all in the title of the study. That's the name of the study if you want to look it up from Amazon at home. And I'll quote directly from the study. Only they looked at 247 people who had kidney stones, and they looked at their gut microbiome, and quote, only 17% of the 247 stone subjects were colonized with oxalobacter, the bacteria that eats these oxalates. Why? Because they weren't eating enough fiber. The American diet is poorly low in fiber. Without feeding the bacteria, they die off naturally. Using antibiotics can bring them down even more. And so only 17% of those who actually had kidney stones actually had these any of these oxalobacter bacteria in their gut at all. So this is really telling us that one, we need to consume more fiber, and two, be very cautious about our use of antibiotics to make sure that we're not over or unnecessarily using them because it can put it at risk for other health issues that may or may not be. So they did further studies on this, and I'm going to post up these two next studies in the comment section. So these are two studies, and I'm just going to read them out to you. The first study is the use of antibiotics and the risk of kidney stones. So that's the name of the study if you want to look it up, The Use of Antibiotics and Risk of Kidney Stones. And I'll quote directly from the study and this one too as well. Recent evidence suggests a possible causal role of antibiotics in the development of kidney stones. A possible explanation for this finding includes alterations in the microbiome caused by the antibiotics, especially in oxalate degrading bacteria like O. formigenes, or the oxalobacter bacteria. There they say it pretty plainly. Causal role of antibiotics in the development of kidney stones. So we know that a healthy gut with plenty of this bacteria will neutralize the negative effects of the oxalates and the plants. And these plants, the plants that are high in oxalates, guess what they're also high in? Fiber. Guess what fiber feeds? The oxalobacteria and bacteria. Perfect. So that's the problem is, and I know, Raymond, you asked a great question. I'm going to put that question up on the screen for everybody. Do you think we can get too much oxalates in too many green smoothies or green juices? Not green smoothies, because you're using the fiber. Remember, the fiber is feeding the bacteria, and you raise those oxalobacteria, and they can munch up that oxalate. So that's not the problem. Juicing, however, you're squeezing out the juice, so you're still getting the oxalates, but you're not getting any of the fiber. That can be a problem, because now you're not feeding the good bacteria that can eat those oxalates, because you've removed all of its food source, the fiber. So I would not suggest green juices, but more green smoothies, which is putting the whole greens into the smoothie. Also, you can use lower oxalate greens. Kale is a little bit lower than spinach for sure. So there are different ones, and you can just look that up on the internet on which plants are a little bit lower in oxalates, but high in fiber. So that's what you want. It's a little bit lower oxalates, higher in fiber, and you're probably going to get more into the safety zone. The problem is the vast majority of Americans aren't getting enough fiber at all, way below the recommendations. And now the recommendations, based on new research coming out about how important fiber is, shows that we're probably way off on the consumption. That, you know, I believe that the consumption of fiber should be about 2 to 3 times of what we do, what we're looking at. I think the fiber recommendations are like 24 grams or something like that. And I think it should be like 50 to 100 grams per day, which you can easily get on a standard plant-based diet, but what you don't get when you're eating an animal-based diet. Because remember, how much fiber is in any animal product? Meat, dairy, fish, eggs, cheese. Zero fiber. None of those products have any fiber at all. Okay, so now we know that we've got this amazing relationship between these studies. The studies are showing it, that the use of antibiotics are causing this. I'll put it up on the screen for just a moment. These are the two studies. Antibiotic use and risk of kidney stones in female nurses. And the second study, was the use of antibiotic and the risk of kidney stones. So they looked at nurses, female nurses, and the results of that study showed cumulative use of antibiotics for a total of 2 or more months during the age range of 40 to 49 years of age was associated with significantly higher risk for developing kidney stones compared to those with no use of antibiotics, because you're basically knocking out the bacteria that would eat up those oxalates. And that's the problem, is we're killing off the bacteria and then we're not supplying enough food for that bacteria to replenish itself. And that's why that previous study that I mentioned showed only 17% of those who had kidney stones had enough of this bacteria, or any of them, the bacteria at all, just because they weren't consuming enough fiber and or use of antibiotics or other bad diet. Now I'm going to get into the other bad diet part, because this is important. So the last part was, well, all right, well, then can we repopulate this bacteria? Yes, this should happen on its own on a healthy-based diet. The bacteria are everywhere. They're on the surface of everything we touch, everything we eat, all that we breathe. They're microscopic and they're everywhere. So our body can do it. Also, we have our a little storage vesicle in our colon that actually helps hold some of these bacteria to replenish the gut when we have a poisoning or diarrhea or flu or virus or something that flushes us out and wipes out our bacteria. That's how our microbiome can get replenished or recharged. It does that on its own. So what we have to do is just feed it the proper amounts of fiber. Increasing your amount of daily intake of fiber can help you get there and get there sooner. Obviously, taking a probiotic that contains Oxalobacter in it can also replenish it too as well. If talk to your physician about that, if you're needing to take antibiotics and don't want to put yourself at the risk of kidney stones, ask if they can get you a prescription possibly of Oxalobacter bacteria so that you can replenish your body stores quickly and not put you at that risk. So, but again, talk with your physician. I am not a medical professional. I'm not giving any professional advice, just conversationally. Okay, so let's talk about that gut homeostasis. So we covered that that the recolonization of the whole internal microbiome can happen on a single dose. So this is how quickly the Oxalobacter bacteria can take hold. Remember, they eat oxalates. So if you're not eating dark greens that contain oxalates, that's their food supply too, and they'll disappear. And they've shown that in the studies, the lower the oxalates, the lower the amount of bacteria. That's homeostasis. That's how our body keeps that in homeostasis. So again, with the fiber, so it's fiber increases the oxalobacteria. And I'll put up the name of the bacteria on the screen so everybody can see it. And there's the name of it. It's called Oxalobacter formigenes, or formigenes. Oxalobacter formigenes. Really cool bacteria that munches up this oxalate, but it goes twofold. Not only does it eat up the oxalates, it actually talks to our cells through cell signaling to let our body not only know that there's some coming in, but to get our body to actually flush out the oxalates that are present, so that load of dietary oxalates is not creating an imbalance. It's keeping us in homeostasis. Now, what other things besides antibiotics can disturb the microbiome? Well, fiber eating bacteria compete with, these are the good guys, right? The guys that do all the health, the probiotics, meaning pro our health. They're biotics, meaning bacteria, that are pro our health. So there are bad bacteria that also exist in our body, and they consume animal products. So they thrive in a bile environment, and bile is secreted by our body to help break down high dense proteins like animal proteins and animal fats. So our bile goes up, and when there's bile there, that's where bad bacteria can thrive. They thrive in a bile environment. So every time you consume an animal product, you're increasing the bad bacteria, but you're also squishing out the good bacteria. So they compete for a space in each other's. And when they die, they can actually kill each other off. So good guys kill off the bad guys, so you want more of the good guys. When they die or apoptize, they burst and they send out little chemicals that kill the bad bacteria. So every time one of your bacteria, or lots of them, millions and billions of them, actually die, we recycle some of the proteins. Thank you very much for that. But we also, those send out chemicals to kill off bad bacteria. And that is a homeostasis in case bad bacteria start killing all the good bacteria. When they die or are killed by the bad bacteria, they'll actually send out chemicals that will cause the death of the bad bacteria in order to keep those bad bacteria in check. But every time you eat an animal product, be it dairy, fish, eggs, milk, meat, chicken, doesn't matter. Those high fats and proteins then cause the bad bacteria to blossom and push down. So we've seen those on a high meat-based diet actually have low or no oxalobacter bacteria. And this is twofold. One, when you're eating more meat, which has zero fiber, you're consuming less fiber, but you're also creating more bad bacteria, which then die off this. So the good bacteria. So you're doing it twofold. When you're eating meat, you're not eating plants, and therefore you're not eating any fiber. And then when you're eating meat, you're also pushing down the good bacteria, the growth of the good bacteria. So it's a twofold every time you are eating animal products, negative as far as the good bacteria are concerned. And it's a twofold positive when you're eating that fiber, you're also getting all the rest of the plant nutrients that are helpful, including polyphenols and other things that actually then get eaten by the bacteria and produce these wonderful metabolite chemicals like butyrates or propionates. These are amazing metabolites, leftovers, stuff that the bacteria in our gut poop out, but they're beneficial to us. So that's a really cool part of it. So high fiber diet increases oxalobacter, and a diet of animal protein and fat increases pathogenic bacterioides. This is the pathogenic type of bacteria, the bad bacteria that live in our gut, and decreases oxalobacter. So they've shown in this study, just one dose, a single oral, I'll read the quote directly from the study, a single oral ingestion of O. formigenes by adult volunteers was for the first time shown to result in reduced urinary oxalate excretion, following administration of an oxalate load. So basically the bacteria chewed up so much of the oxalates, there was less being peed out. And it's the peeing out of it where the kidney stones, obviously in our kidneys, form. And this is where the problem arises. So lower excretion means less getting into the system because the bacteria on one single dose of that bacteria changed immediately how much oxalate is being released during the urine. So we know that eating animal products puts you at higher risk for kidney stones. We know that. There's literally hundreds of studies that show that. There are other things like drinking soda, which are high in oxalates, can also form this. Because remember, there's zero fiber in soda. High oxalates, zero fiber, the worst possible combination. What you want is, doesn't matter the oxalates, but how much fiber so that you're feeding those oxalate eating bacteria so that there is a homeostasis. It's not causing a negative effect on the body. So oxalate uptake from the gut into the bloodstream is regulated by human cells communicating directly to oxalate-consuming microbiota. End quote. However, the precise signaling molecules and pathways involved in this physiological bacteria to the host, that's our own body and our gut bacteria, have yet to be elucidated. So they don't know what are the actual chemical messengers, but they know our gut microbiome is talking to our healthy cells and sending a cascade of messaging throughout our body in order to balance the body and keep it in homeostasis. So one of the reasons why I really like clean green protein is because of the lentine in it. It is low in oxalates, high in fiber, but also high, really rich in the micronutrients, high in pectin, which is a probiotic fiber that specifically feeds bacteria in our gut, the good guys. It's high in omega-3s, it's high in protein, it's high in micronutrients, it's high in polyphenols. As a matter of fact, it is lentine or the duckweed, the water lentils in clean green protein are the richest source of micronutrients and macronutrients combined of any plant that we know of. That's the proper way to get your greens in on a daily basis and not worry about oxalate load, because it's low in oxalates, high in fiber, feeding those oxalate eating bacteria so that it doesn't put you at risk for any oxalate issues. I hope you've enjoyed this one. Let's get beyond some of these attacks by other people, which are fear-based. Oh, don't eat phytates or don't eat oxalates. This is not really real. When you dive into the mechanisms that our body does, our body is this amazing symphony of self-regulating, self-balancing, self-healing mechanisms that if we just understand what it is that is going on from the time it hits our mouth to our gut, into our bloodstream, into our tissues, conversions all the way, metabolized and out, we can see that a whole food plant-based diet is definitely the way to go, or getting those nutrients in from supplementation like vitamin D3 if we're not exposed to sun. So these are great ways to do it by using clean green protein, which has a whole food nutrient-rich plant-based source of protein in it, in lentine. Happy to be the very first person to bring that to market. Winner of the Nexty Award, you can see behind me right there, for the best supplement of the year. Excited to bring these types of information to you so that you can rest assured. Yes, you do need to be concerned. If you have kidney stones already, do talk to your doctor about it. But increasing that fiber, now that we know it is very clear, a healthy microbiome should lead to much less concern about the oxalates or the phytates that are in our food. And we shouldn't be concerned about phytates or lectins at all. These are anti-cancer agents. I don't know why anybody would consider these bad when they're actually protecting us from dying. For God's sakes, these are anti-cancer agents. IP6 or phytic acid or phytates is anti-cancer. There's multiple studies on that. Look up IP6 or phytic acid or phytates, and you can see how they destroy cancer cells. They can even reverse cancer cells, change them back to healthy human cells. This is amazing. If you want some more information on why plant-based protein is better than animal-based protein, why plant-based omega-3 is better and more natural to our genome than animal-sourced omega-3, like EPA and DHA from fish. If you want more information on why vitamin K is better from plants, if you want more information on why vitamin A is better from plants, I have those videos on it. You can go to YouTube at Clean Machine Online, and you can get these videos. And they're all based on the real studies. I share the studies with you. I quote the studies verbatim, so I'm not ad-libbing anything. There's plenty of information out there that almost all of the micronutrients and macronutrients are superior in their plant-based form to any of the nutrients that you get. Iron, plant-based iron versus heme iron. I did a video on that recently. Vitamin K, vitamin A, B6. Higher B6 in vegans than in those who are not on a strict plant-based diet. Over and over and over and over again, the science is telling the same story. We are genetically, physiologically designed to be optimal health based on a plant-based diet, getting all of our micro and macronutrients from plants because they're significantly different. They're chemically different. The plant-based proteins, higher in methionine. Methionine can form homocysteine, which can lead to heart attacks, high blood pressure, hardening of the arteries, cardiovascular disease, all of these things. Highest in plant and in animal proteins, low methionine in it. Methionine feeds cancer cells. This is a known entity. They're even called methionine-dependent cancers. So every time you eat that high methionine animal product, whether it's fish, eggs, dairy, they're all high in methionine, you are feeding cancer cells and potentially can cause metastasis of cancer cells by consuming that. And that's why we see such majorly high higher risk for cancer, for heart attacks, for strokes, all of these disease states coming from the consumption of animal products. I don't say this because I want to be on one side or another. It's not about sides. It's about your health and your quality of life. I improved my health and my quality of life. It's such a gift to me. I want to pay it forward. And I want to make sure that you have the information to make the best decisions so that you can live the healthiest, happiest, disease-free, pain-free, suffering-free life and enjoy it. You know, I'm almost 60 years of age, great health, great shape, no drugs, no medical visits. I haven't seen, the only time I see doctors is when I visit some of my plant-based doctor friends. That's the only time I ever see a doctor because I don't need to. And it's a wonderful feeling to have my life back, to have that sense of empowerment. That's what I want for you. That's why I share this information, why I'm so passionate about getting this information, because there's a lot of disinformation out there that is designed to based on fear, trying to scare you away or trying to say my side is right, your side is wrong because X. It's like, come on, let's don't do that. The body didn't design itself bad. The nature hasn't designed itself bad. We are designed to eat plants. And the science is over and over and over and over again showing that's exactly what the case is. I hope you enjoyed this one. If you do, share, tell your friends, bring some other people back, watch it, because I'll be sharing lots more of these types of deep dive information with the studies that you can read for yourself and make the decision that's right for you so that you can live the healthiest, happiest life. Enjoy.